Patna. He is director of another well-established social science institute, A. Sinha Institute in Patna. I leave the introduction to speakers to you.
Thank you so much. thank you. I purposely thank this is ADRI for having invited me to be here with you all to participate in a seminar which is very important for every one of us who have been working in the field of social sciences. education is of course is a very important area in which you have a lot of course information that who have been working in the field of education, they have been encountering serious problems also in terms of understanding the problems in its magnitude and scale all over the country. Not only insufficiency but also the quality aspect of the data. Even yesterday also in the meeting it was discussed number of times. You know that has been there always and coming on the way, but at this particular forum could be able to give us some sort of insights and inputs to see that how really we'll be able to get out of the kind of problem that we have been facing dealing with the set of data while talking about the development of education in the country like India. Let me have the pleasure of introducing my colleagues who are in the dais who are here. One, the discussants are one Vikas, Dimble. He is a country economist, International Growth Center, International Growth IGC India Central Program. Is Vikas Dimble? Yeah. Yes, you are Vikas Dimble. Yes. Then we have Sudhanshu Kumar, Assistant Professor, National Institute of Public Finance and Policy. Mr. Sudhanshu. Yeah. We have these two discussants with us. And the first presentation is going to be made by Yagnamurthy, Sreekanth, Professor and Head, Educational Survey Division, NCERT. His topic is on students' educational achievement at school level and analysis across social categories. I'll be very eager to hear any more on this particular topic. Anugula N. Reddy is Assistant Professor, National University of Educational Planning and Administration. And his topic is on school education statistics in India, the changing status and persisting problems. Then third presentation will be on by Pradeep Kumar Choudhury. He is Assistant Professor of Jawaharlal Nehru University. His topic is on institutional base of educational statistics in India, implications for new education policy. That's a very interesting area on which now the whole of this country, especially those who have been working in the field of education, have been really trying to find out the way, what kind of policy formulation that could be there for the new education policy. Am I right? Something which you are all eager to hear you on that, and the kind of statistical leverage that you can give for producing your arguments. And then the presentation of Professor Ford, Mr. M. K. Jamwal. He is a professor, professor of Ranchi University. His topic is the trend analysis of India's adult literacy initiative. We have very resourceful, highly educated, and and the kind of topic, research people over here in the dash and the kind of topics they have taken up is something which could be very much stimulative for us to understand the depth and the kind of depth of the problems, the limitations, and so on and so forth. So, with these very few words, I may request before the session begins, I have few requests to make. Each one should not take more than 15 minutes. Let us really confine ourselves. The time limit is, we have the limitation of time, and therefore not more than 15 minutes time. And secondly, each one, any question and answer, we have always a tendency to deep dive on the main thing and go on. I mean, each one is valid, no doubt about that. But then we need to really see how contextually we are relevant to while asking a question or making an observation should be very cryptic, short, and see that it is very much within the limits of the context in which we are talking about. This is my request to all of you. With these very few words, may I request, that the presentation should begin? The first president, Professor Sreekanth, may I request you to kindly make your presentations on school educational achievement at school, students' achievement in schools, level analysis across social categories. Professor Sreekanth.
Good afternoon, the chairperson and all other esteemed delegates.
Switch on the mic, please.
As you all know that the National Council of Educational Research and Training, which is the APEX advisory body for the Ministry of Human Resource Development, has been conducting the nationwide achievement surveys at different levels of school education. So I'll be making a presentation on the performance of students under different social categories in this particular presentation. I'll be explaining about how different social categories, that is general category, other students and scheduled castes, scheduled tribes and OBC students are performing with regard to their education and the quality and various aspects that I'll be discussing. We all know that education can bring about socio-economic change. And that is happening all across, especially as you see, a rickshaw puller's son can become an IAS, Indian Administrative Service Officer, and the group of 30 that you have in Bihar, who have been doing extremely well over the period of time. The power of education emanates not from provisioning and mere provisioning that we all see in government school system, which has not been appreciated much over the period of time, but it emanates from quality, and now the focus is on quality and not simply provision. And when we try to understand education, and we talk about quality, it is about provisions, processes, and outcomes. We cannot simply talk about one of these three and say that educational quality depends on that particular aspect. NCERT is involved in all these things in terms of provisions. We monitor the quality provisions across the school system through All India School Education Surveys, periodically conducted, like the census surveys. This is the second biggest one after the census. And the processes are monitored through CC, continuous and comprehensive evaluation, and the outcomes are monitored through nationwide achievement surveys. Without going into the quote, I would certainly mention this particular last sentence, which is very important. The ideal, of course, is to figure out the right organizational mix that will result in increased achievement means and decreased standard deviations around these means. So this is what is expected when we talk about education. And since 2001 and 2, the SSA, Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, ever since it was launched, the country was also interested in knowing how students are performing, so that is why nationwide achievement surveys have been initiated. And the main intention is to see whether the learning outcomes of the students have been attained across socioeconomic groups and gender categories. The performance is compared, the performance is seen in terms of comparisons of different groups across stages of schooling, that is grade 3, 8, 5, and 8. The mean achievement of students at state and national level gives a fair idea of how the progress is being made. The analysis in this particular presentation is confined to mathematics and languages because these are considered very important in terms of literacy and numeracy. The conceptual definition of educational quality is that the same opportunity to enroll in, remain, excel during, and graduate from an educational program. Largely in the Western countries, you might have, the researchers do observe that the home background exerts an independent influence on academic achievement. This has significant achievement right from 1960s. The researchers have confirmed this. And my study would like to see whether this is being confirmed through our studies or not. Students from high socioeconomic classes have higher achievement levels than students from lower social classes. Provisions should be adequate and comparable in quality in school system. If they are not, then certainly it will make the difference. The educational outcomes, impact of socioeconomic opportunities to be accessed at global levels. So this has an important impact. And this particular national achievement surveys, like I pointed out earlier, under different subjects, how the students are performing, and with regard to area, gender, and social groups, how they are performing, and how the home background, so teachers' impact and students' achievement, they matter. All these three aspects are seen together. Several rounds of surveys have been conducted at different stages, class 3, 5, and 8. The students' background, teachers' variables, and school variables are taken into consideration. And these are the cycles under which the students' achievement surveys are conducted, and the states, districts, and schools and teachers who have participated in these surveys. Broadly, these are the figures. When it comes to the coverage, the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, OBC, and other categories of population surveyed, the percentage of the students is this. Even the national achievement surveys do confirm that the mean achievement of students and the different categories in languages across the cycles and stages indicate that other category students have performed better than OBC, and OBC students have performed better than SC and ST category students. So this is the general, macro level picture that you get when you see the performance of the students. Though there are certain exceptions at certain cycles. So this is cycle 1, 2, 3 of class 3 in language. So though ST population is on par and slightly ahead of general category, this is not the scenario if you observe over the cycles and across the stages. This is class 5 language. As you can see, the general category students are ahead of OBC and SC and ST. So this is for class 8 language. Here also you can see the difference. And then this is class 3 mathematics, the general OBC, SC, ST categories. And this is the performance in mathematics class 5. And this is class 8 mathematics. Okay, then I'll come to the findings. At national level, other category students' performance is better than OBC, like I mentioned, and OBC then that of SC and ST. At state level, there are some exceptions. In class 3 mathematics, SC students, especially in smaller states like Mizoram and Nagaland, that is northeastern states, across the cycles, the students have performed well. SC students have performed, though they are in minority, than others, OBC and ST students. In Puducherry, ST students have performed better than all others in class 3. In all the three cycles, that means over the period of time, then other than these, the performance of SCST students is not consistently better than others, general category students in any subject or stage of school education over the cycles. SCST students' performance is better in smaller states and or belonging to northeastern region. This is an interesting finding. The initial gains made by these students in class 3, they are not sustained at later stages, that is class 5 and 8. Then, when it comes to educational qualification of parents and students' achievement, there is a close correlation. And as you see that, you know, about 20 to 25% of the children's fathers and the various surveys are illiterate and under all categories. What is observed is that many of them are, you know, from very low literacy background. Their parents' educational background is very poor. The class 5, 4, in the class 5, 4 cycle, the number of fathers with illiteracy is lower than other cycles. But since this is the recent round that was conducted, it shows some improvement over the cycles, you know, that literacy is increasing. About 20 to 33% across the cycles, the fathers are educated up to primary level only, and along with illiterate and literate fathers, it amounts to 50%. So the family support that these children can get is very meager. Then students' mathematics mean achievement in relation to fathers' educational qualification also shows a clear progression in the mean achievement of their children. So mothers' educational qualification is also very much related. Achievement of students with illiterate mothers is about 64.38%, but whereas it is 71.40%. for students with mothers up to graduation and above. Then SC category students' parents have lower educational qualifications than others category students, and this is one of the reasons why the students' performance across categories also varies. If you, through two-way ANOVA, when their estimates of marginal means, the educational status of father is analyzed. So this is the graph that you get, you know. If there is an improvement in the educational qualifications of father, it has a positive impact on the achievement of the students. Then when it comes to occupational status, again, the children, about 21 to 48% of the fathers are agricultural laborers or daily wages. So in the sense, largely, who are going to our government and government-aided schools, where this survey is conducted, it largely gives a fair idea of how the socioeconomic background of these children. Less than 2% of fathers are teachers or senior professionals whose children's achievement is very high. In class 3 survey, 48.09% of the fathers are agricultural laborers or daily wages. Only about 0.8% account for manager or senior level officers, and about 55% of the fathers belong to unorganized sector and have insecure employment, which has implications on the educational quality of their children, because if they themselves are not secure, how can they provide quality education to their children? The children with unemployed fathers have a mean achievement of 62.99%. Agricultural laborers have little higher, and the manager or senior level officers have still higher percentage of achievement. So that means to say that the performance of the children is closely related with the occupational status of the father. The employment status of the mother, like in the case of father, has a positive association with mean achievement of students, with housewife mother being lower than that of mothers who are teacher or senior level officers. This is also because they are largely from poor background and with literacy levels being low, so they cannot support their children. The study underlines the importance of family support in the students' achievement. Parental educational qualification and employment status matter significantly and positively in the achievement of the students at macro level, though it may and not be so at the individual level, I mean, then multiple disadvantages that certain sections of students' population face, such as SCST girls with poor economic background, also hinder achievement. In order to bring about improvement in the learning among disadvantaged sections of the society, I mean, especially the quality of teaching, learning, and the materials, they need to improve in the school system. The challenge of raising the standards of education must happen at primary level, as this is the most sensitive stage, and if that does not happen, then the accumulated burden that the children will have a huge impact on dropping out. The economic status has overwhelming impact on students' achievement than the social status, and as the students belonging to higher economic status with better educational qualifications and occupational status have higher learning achievement irrespective of the social category. So that means to say that the basic idea is to bring about improved literacy rates and also their educational and occupational status. The key takeaway from this study is that quality education leads to better employment opportunities, and it not only benefits the students when in the future, it affects their children's performance also. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you. We'll take up for discussion at the end, after the discussion's presentation.
So, thank you so much. May I invite Dr. Reddy to present his paper on school education statistics in India, changing status and persisting problem.
Good morning, friends. And let me first, thank ADRI for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts about this school education statistics. Let me also share that I work in Nepal, but the views or opinions expressed in this presentation are mine only, should not be attributed to in any way inferred as the Nepal's opinions. These are purely my personal opinions. What I will do is that I will briefly discuss about the different sources of education statistics in India, then I will move on to how to institutionalize the statistical collection mechanism in education are the challenges involved there. And the individual sources of data, detailed information was given in my paper. Whoever wants that paper, I can also share it. As perhaps in this audience, I need not have to elaborate on that. Linkages between education and development and every aspect of social indicator, be it nutrition, mortality rates, or crime rates, our employment opportunities that inextricably linked with education. And therefore, education is a critical component, and therefore, statistics and education is also a very, very critical component. Perhaps this kind of linkages with development has led to include education as one of the important indicator our target, our goal, rather, in SDGs, that SDGs 4 is ensure inclusion, equitable, and quote unquote quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all. Though there was emphasis on this quality aspect, maybe in Jamaica, in Dhaka, and in MDGs also, but that has never came to fore so effectively as it is in these MDGs. In fact, there is a huge activities going on to develop metrics to measure quality, but at this moment of time, I'm not talking about that. The institutional framework for collection of the statistics, as you know, MHRD, Minister of Human Resources Development, is an agency that is invested with collection and dissemination of data on school education. And this is constrained, of course, by education being the concurrent subject. Both state governments and the central government share the responsibility, and states have their own issues, and MHRD has to depend on states while collecting and disseminating data on education. The institutional, there are two sources of data on education. An institutional source is that MHRD, this in the parlance of education statistics called administrative data, MHRD, GY is the principal source, and NCERT also collects data on supposedly clinical basis, but from one survey to another survey, there is more gap than we have 5 years. NCERT collects data in the name of All India Survey on School Education, All India Survey on School Education, AISES, though it's named as a survey, but it's basically a census of all schools across the country. The latest survey was, data are being released now, but it relates to the 2009, that's 8th survey. I'll come to that later. NUPA, where I work, we are disseminating data in the name of DICE for the last more than 1.5 decade. More or less from 2005-06, basically 2002-03 onwards, but we would say that 2005-06 onwards, the coverage is entirely all India. UGC, AICT, Planning Commission, IIM, and other agencies that also disseminate data on education of different aspects, particularly on higher education. As far as household data, there are different sources, agencies also disseminate data, NSSO, NCER, NFHS, NCER basically IDHS survey, NFHS, Pratham, and special studies households by Government of India from research in and market consulting, consultants, firms, and after school children, attendance or absence of teachers and purposes and dropouts, things of that kind. Latest after school children data was conducted by IMRB. Yes, it relates to 12-13 or so, maybe 12-13 or 13-14, something like that. These are basically different sources. More details are given in my book, but I'm not going to the details of what are the limitations or strengths of each source. From 1990 onwards, the context for education changed. One important aspect is that introduction of external funding in education, primary education for the first time. Though people claim that during early 90s it was resisted, but ultimately by 1994, at all India level, Government of India has accepted external funding in the name of DPEP. There is also an immigration judgment and pressure from civil society to enact RTE, though RTE was made as a fundamental right in 2002 or I don't remember exactly, but the act was made only in 2009. Subsequent to DPEP, there was a large-scale activities like SSA, Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, that coverages entire India, and RMSA, Rashtriya Madhyamika Shiksha Abhiyan, coverages entire India, but of course only for grades 9th and 10th, that secondary education, not full secondary education, only the lower secondary education of it is covered. Besides these, the international declarations from 1990 onwards, Jamitian and later Dhaka, MDGs of now, SDGs, these are also putting lots of pressure on data. But what was the condition around 1990s? 1990s, the only source of data on education is MHRD, and it is MHRD data are plagued by this kind of problems, low reliability. Nobody believes that MHRD enrollment figures are right, and they're usually overestimated, fictitious, you know, whatever things are. And comparability is also one of the problems. And second, the third thing is that inaccurate and persistent time lags. Say, for example, when I came to NUPA around 2000s, and I was actually, when I go to MHRD data, I would able to access only for the 1990s, 91, 92, 93 kind of thing. So there is a huge gap of at least of 7 to 8 years in case of enrollment data, and more than 10 years in case of financial data. So this is one of the important constraints when people try to use MHRD data. The third thing is that MHRD data is aggregated data. You don't find any data at a district level or below the district is out of question. So these are some of the issues that were confronted by education system then when the DPEP was launched in 1994. Yeah, large scale, resource intensive, mission mode, target oriented and externally funded programs, when these were launched, these require what one can say that required data to make disaggregate plans, DPP, district level plans, and disaggregated and reliable, quote unquote, and least time that data required. This need was met by initiating District Information System for Education at NUPA that was extended to all over the country along with the expansion of DICE, along with the expansion of SSA to country. Secondary education management information was SEMIS, now it is discontinued, was also initiated in 2009-10 as part of RMSA, but later it was merged with UDIS. NUPA was responsible, when DICE and SEMIS was merged, it was called as UDICE. NUPA is responsible for compilation and dissemination of data under UDICE, and further data has been collected on various items, like also. These attempts since 19 have bypassed. One of the important aspects of whatever the attempts that were made for collection of data to meet various requirements is that the whole, from ranging from DICE to studies on out-of-school children via attendance studies, these have bypassed mainstream, state-level mainstream statistical departments located in the directorates of school education. One of the reasons could be GPEP and SSA and RMSA have separate project administration at state and below state level. At state level, you have a SPD, that is state project officer, and at state project directorate, and below him, there are a large number of people are working, and at the district level, district project officer is there. So there are parallel structures were created under DPEP and SSA. Since, DICE is also kind of part of SSA and DPEP, whatever you have initiated, then this has become a kind of parallel to the system. So mainstream system was bypassed. MHRD and DICE have functioned in parallel till 2011. MHRD also continued to produce the data till around 2011-12, and DICE used to also produce data, even now it produces, at least from 2005-06 onwards, it is all India level data, its kind of coverage is relatively complete. But despite this, that these two are functioning and disseminating data separately, obviously one will find large number of differences from DICE to ACS. In both enrollment, even number of schools, there is a huge variation there. NCERT also disseminates data from All India Survey of School Education Stats, All India Survey of School Education. 7th survey 2002-03, but 8th survey 2019. 2019 has been, data is trickling down just now. I have compared this 2019 All India Survey data with DICE data, and I found at national level, perhaps the picture is a little narrowed down in the sense that in some states DICE is higher, in some states All India Survey is higher, so therefore they cancel out, and at national level you won't find any big, not so big, but there are differences, but not so big differences. But the moment you go to state level, up to the point of 20%, even in number of simple indicator like number of schools, the coverage that All India Survey gives a totally different number, what NUPA or DICE gives is totally different number. So all bigger states, 20 states have covered, and there is no uniform pattern. In some states, it's DICE which gives more numbers, and in some states, it's All India Survey that gives more numbers. So there are no typical patterns that are. So for example, I have compared both primary, upper primary, I have compared private and government schools, and in all respects, the numbers never matches. Eventually, used to publish a large number of publications. Education in India, there are volume 1 to 4, depending on different aspects, and the education, school education starts, and now, latest, not exactly now, starts in school education. Selected education starts is replaced by starts in school education, in the year maybe around 2009-10 or so. But these publications were more or less discontinued. Education in India has no, even nobody has written arbitrary to Education India, but it's died down. The latest year for which data are available 10 years back is 2000, something like that. Selected education statistics was reproduced as statistics and school education. It was discontinued with an administrative decision by school education department of MHRD. These were discontinued recently. What a decision was, it was decided to use DICE data. So a decision was taken to stop parallel collection by MHRD. And also not only this MHRD publications were discontinued, but also the NCERT survey, the All India School Education Survey, was also quote unquote discontinued in the sense that whatever the variables that are available in DICE, on those variables AIS will not collect data, but it only collects, did I overshoot my time?
1 minute.
Oh, I think I should, I think this will not help me. The point I'm trying to say is that since MHRD statistics were discontinued and the possibility of NCERT initiating the ninth survey is uncertain, if not totally abolished, then the UDIS data is only the source of data on school education today, as in today. For the last 2 to 3 years, UDIS is the only source of data. What is UDIS? UDIS doesn't have a permanent structure to collect the data. It's part of SSA and RMSA state mechanisms. The person, due to this huge capacity, is created at the state, below sub-state, and cluster level source. People can very quickly use computers to enter the data, to manipulate the data, to do whatever you want to do. Huge capacity was created. Huge infrastructure was created. Throw this structure blockage to block resources and BRCs, CRCs, district project offices, and state offices. But the question is, it remains in project. No, not only teachers, but also all the personnel who are managing the project at district level, at state level, at cluster level, are basically project personnel who doesn't have a permanent tenure. Whereas, by default, UDIS was given official status of structure, because almost all the functions now MHRD does is done by UDIS.
Now I think it's over. You tell what the problem is. The problem continuing is persisting the problem, no?
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah, I mean, there are a lot many, I think. So this raises the question of what is the sustainability of school education statistics in India. That's number one. Number two, even after this, a large number of states not able to meet their requirements from UDIS have started alternative mechanisms. If you go to Maharashtra, Saral is there. If you go to Maharashtra, Samagra is there. If you go to Orissa, you have some other thing. So even now, the states are creating alternative mechanisms to collect data to meet their own requirements. And third, even now, the issues of reliability of data, particularly enrollment, also infrastructure, are not resolved. So these are some of the persisting issues despite these changes. Thank you.
Thank you so much. May I now invite Dr. Choudhury, Pradeep Kumar Choudhury, to speak on institutional base of educational statistics in India, implications for new education policies.
Yeah, good afternoon to all. I thank ADRI for getting me here, particularly Dr. Gupta, to invite me for this. I'm going to talk on the topic of institutional base of educational statistics in India and its implications for the current. That way I'm going to talk. I'll skip some of the points because some of the points have already been spelled out by Dr. Reddy in some of the points, like education development, that we already know in this kind of audience.
Can you zoom the slides, you're able to read?
Yeah. Sorry?
Can you zoom the slides now?
It's not visible.
Zoom. Okay. Enlarge it.
Yeah. Is it fine? Yeah, so there is a context of education and development that we know, because the role of education in all kinds of development, including, we talk about human development, economic development, social development, cultural development, all development, how education is linked. Education is highly interrelated with many other sectors, including employment, demography, health, and you can list a more, like some more sectors where education is interrelated. The third one is, these are the different contexts that I am putting for my paper. The third one is structural and systematic changes in the education sector, including the education and other sector. While I'm telling other sectors, that I mean the how education is interrelated with other sectors. That's the importance of saying many other sectors. So there is a structural change and there is a need for looking at the importance of education sector. The fourth one is, like, in keeping all these in view, like, we are trying to emphasize the educational planning, how we make an effective educational planning, and there the role of social and other social and educational statistics in it. The point I'm trying to bring is how other sectors are integrated with education and how they can look in a holistic manner. That's the importance of saying these points. In writing the paper, when I was thinking how I will interrelate the institutional base of educational statistics and how to link it with the new education policies, I found some of the points. Why those things I am trying to bring in the motivation. The first one is use of statistics for evidence-based decision-making. That is across the sectors that is applicable, including the education, where the importance that is already been spelled out for the last day also. Today even Dr. Alker, Sabina Alker, she also mentioned that how statistics important in making evidence-based decision-making. That is already known to us. The second one is the importance, the second one I am trying to come into the education sector is importance of informational base for national policies on education. We had already two national policies on education, like 1968 policy and the second one in 1986, modified in 1992. In all the cases, we have looked at how we are lacking in informational base, by which we are trying to get a different kind of educational policy. And in the implementation part also, we are getting difficulty. That I will come a little later. So, the point I am trying to say is how use of aggregational statistics, aggregate level statistics in India, in state level or in country level, how those are important in making the policies. The third one is wide consultation for the new education policy. In this new education policy that we have in the draft format now, we had a huge consultation process including the block level, district level, village level, school level, state level and all the levels. So there we have what I am trying to put here, we have a limited understanding of the process of formulating the policy, particularly the education policy. Why I am saying so? Because we always thought of getting something from the ground will make solve our problem in that way, like getting through the consultation process. But my point is, I'll elaborate that a little later, how these points that were being collected, being aggregated and used in the policy making, that is a question mark for us. So getting the information and using it for the policies are two different things. Also, I am finding we are not getting any attempt. We are doing some empirical research in education economics or education with development, but we are not trying to understand many researchers how the importance of these statistics in the policy making, that we are lacking. And how in the ground level, particularly in the education sector, I am not getting many research where we are trying to understand the importance of that statistics. In this context, my paper will focus on two important points. The first will be, it will discuss the institutional base of educational statistics in India, situating the statistical base for educational planning. That's the idea, first part. I think some of the things have already been covered by Reddy, so I'll skip some of the things. The second part, which Professor Roy also told is very important, is to study the implications of limited educational statistics that we have on new education policy that we have come up, the draft one, which aims for a major change in the Indian education system. Because that is one of the, last one was in 86, so we are trying to see many things in the new education policy. So again, saying so, I also want to highlight some of the limitations that in my paper, I will not comment on the recommendations of the new education policy that now very recently it came. I have the draft from my colleagues, but I have read it within a short period. So I am not going to comment on the recommendation they have given. Rather, I will flag for the importance of informational base on formulating the policy. That is the key aspect of my presentation. There are 13 themes on school education. You might have seen that. And 20 themes on higher education are listed in policy consultation material. And this paper will highlight on selected themes, not all the themes. That too particularly in higher education. Why higher education? Because when I looked at the this content of the program, I saw the other two are already speaking on school education. So let me focus on higher education particularly. And also I have a comparatively less disadvantage of working on higher because I work on higher education, not much on school education. So I thought I would take the issues on higher education. This already told I am skipping this because there are major sources of educational statistics that most of you might be knowing and also some of the things spelled out by Dr. Reddy. So there are some major issues, some of the things are already spelled out, but I want to spell some of the important concepts, like conceptual and definitional problems we have in education sector particularly. Then we have quality of data, reliability, comparability that is already being spelled out. Then time lag in data collection, we see, suppose we want to analyze some of the things now, we will get the data of 2009-10 that already spelled out. Lack of coordination among data collection, this is one of the important things. When we are linking the education sector with many other sectors, for example, employment, health, demography, but the institutional mechanisms are not integrated in that way. How MHRT is interacting with Minister of Health and Family Welfare? Because education and health, how they are related, but at the macro level, at the institutional level, they are not interacting. So that is the case. We are lying with, we are heading with many duplication of data, but not the data which actually we need. That's the point. I'm telling one example. Similarly, Minister of Labour, how they are interacting with the Minister of Human Resource Development and the Minister of Health and Family, how they are interacting at that level. That is one of the important issues. Once they are not interacting in the institutional level, we are ending up with many duplication of data which may not be very useful for us. Then the non-availability of private sector statistics, that is one of the important things that I want to highlight. Because when we make some comparison, because now you see the dominance of private sector is very high, particularly in the education sector, including school and higher education, and that is emerging. So in that context, if you have less information on school, education on, from private sector, then how will you make an effective educational framework that we are coming up? Well, that I will come up some of the issues like PPP, public-private partnership and other things we are talking, but we don't have a base for that. Because we are not getting the information that we want, particularly from the private sector. Because there are many issues you might be doing on that. Then weak institutional mechanism to handle the educational statistics. Do we have a proper institutional mechanism except MHRT, which is also not having a good statistics division as such? Yeah, I have visited for some of the reports to the ministry, and I find the lowest employed manpower is available in the educational statistics division of the MHRT, where they look at very like minimal thing in education, collecting education statistics. So that shows the institutional mechanism and the weakness of institutional mechanism that we have to collect the statistics. Then awareness level of stakeholders is minimal. For example, that is persistent in many developing and underdeveloped countries, that who are the people who are giving the information, they are actually not well understood the information. So for example, we are going for NSSO data and other data sets. There the respondents are very weak to understand the things by which we won't get the proper information that we actually need. Coming to the new education policy, this is the second part of my presentation, where the new education policy, the idea was that we had a last such policy was in 1986, which was marginally modified in 1992. And afterwards, there is several changes in the education sector. And also the other sector, which is also impact on the education sector. In that context, we need an education policy. I'm not going to the political economy of that, because there are many other issues which are not very interesting to the academicians, but there are some hidden agendas in that. I'm not going to that. In academics, I'm telling, in academic context, I'm telling the things. So the other thing is, the aim is that the changing needs of the population's requirements with regard to quality education, innovation research, those are the objectives of new education policy. For that, they have thought, the government thought, for wide consultation to generate numerous ideas and policy options. That was the objective, that we will have consultation processes. So many consultation processes by NIPA, by even our center, Jackie Hussain Center in JNU, many consultation, by even NCERT did many things. Regional Institute of Education, they did consultation process, block level consultations. But how this consultation process, the information that will go to being used in the national policy in education, that I think I will tell a little more. Coming to some of the themes I am highlighting here, four major themes I am highlighting where I am a little comfortable. Because I do research on this financing and labor, education, labor market and other issues. So four important things are quality concerns, access and participation, financing of higher education, and skill development and labor market. These are the four important focus in the national policy on education, and I have picked these four important things to discuss on interlinking the implications of educational statistics on these four. Let us come one by one. Quality concerns. I have read the report in a hurry, that's the whole report, which is available with me from my colleague. They are also in the consultation that theme paper, that also I have looked at. I found some of the concerns. Like, we are talking about quality concerns, but what are the different evidences we have till now on quality of education? We have that ASSOC report on school education. When you come to the higher education, what is the quality parameters or quality indicators do we have? We have the ranking, global rankings, which we have many criticism. We have now national institutional ranking framework, NIRF, which is also critical, because only the institution have given the information which is not cross-verified. So there are many issues. So we have least available evidence on quality, but we tell many things on that. The second important thing we tell about the linking quality is teachers. But we have the least understanding on teachers, and particularly teacher and teachers' labor market. Because those are very important in improving the quality. How the teachers are trained, where they are going, why they are not sustaining in some of the institutions. For example, now we came up with in 2009 many central universities. But you see the situations where What are the number of teachers there? Who are also going to those central universities? They are coming up within 2-3 months out of the system. So the understanding the teachers level matter. Do we have any access to that? On the recruitment, salary, I mean, we have a huge criticism in IPI, these things, which are also reflected in the new education policy. Then we have the ranking, which is linked with higher education in quality. But in the ranking, one of the most important things is statistics. But do we have such statistics in comparison, like we are going for global ranking? I think many of the you might be knowing on that. Regulation of private sector, but as I have already mentioned, getting the information is the most difficult task. Even for an individual researcher, it's not about the aggregate level. At least in the government level, they can put an emphasis, put an effort to get that. But as an individual researcher, if you go, they will strictly deny you to give the information. So that kind, in that kind of situation, regulating private sector, giving some policy to private sector, how that will come up? That is an important question mark for us. Then improving state universities. We are talking, I think, yesterday with some of our participants that how the improving the state university, that is an agenda in the new education policy. And they have come up, I have read, they have come up with some suggestions, but I have some fundamental concerns in that. Some of the fundamental concerns like funding. For example, UGC is giving funding. In some of the cases, the state universities are denying to take because they will come under the control of UGC. So they are telling we won't go for that. So that there are some fundamental concerns in state education, state universities that in that context, if you bring new education policy and improving the state university, how it will work?
You have only 1 minute.
Okay, then we have access and participation. The summer issues like, you can read out like on distance learning, that is one is coming up in new education policy. But what we know about distance education, that is very minimal for us. Limited focus on demand side factors. It's not about, when you talk about access and participation, it's not about opening of institutions, higher education institutions. It's about bringing the students to there. So we have less understanding on that. Shifting of cash to time, we are comparing the cash to time framework with the other sectors to education, but I have some issues on that. Like, do we compare the other sector with education as parallel? That is important thing. Because of regional disparity, we are focusing on quantitative evidence, but we have less quantitative evidence on the regional disparity. Partnership with private sector, PPP, that I have already mentioned, but we don't have the basic information on PPP. Do we have any impact studies on PPP as such in higher education sector? We don't have such study. Then where will we stand to go further? Coming to the financing aspect, we have the financing, let's say public financing, but do we have proper data utilization, which is an important factor. It's not about only give the money, it's about the utilization. In school education, we have such...
So I think you have to stop now.
Okay, then...
Let's conclude, that's it.
Yeah.
Usual, make short, not so to speak about everything.
The last slide is, I think, some policy conclusion that already highlighted, the coordination between several agencies. Need to minimize the discrepancy. In the context of new education policy, I want to say that how the peculiarity in the education sector should be looked separately in the consultation process. It's not like other sectors. Similarly, effective use of available educational status, whatever we have in macro sector, how we'll use that also. Also, the draft policy has come and we have now the time to read it carefully and look at how we can say more about that. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Sorry that I have to persuade you to cut short and all that, but you have got enormous wealth of, I mean, your data, information, and then message that you wanted to convey. Thank you so much. May I request Professor Jamur to speak on the trend analysis of India's adult literacy initiatives.
Distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen. My lecture would be different from what you have heard yesterday or you are going to hear in the coming two days. Basically, I am not an economist, I am not a statistician, I am a teacher of environmental sciences, but I got an opportunity to work in the field of adult education. Right from the grassroots level to the policy framing level. I also today thank ADRI for inviting me to this conference. My association with ADRI is pretty long. I first visited ADRI in 1996 when I was given the charge to carry out total literacy campaign in Ranchi district. And ADRI was the state resource center to give us ideas how to implement the total literacy campaign. When I came to ADRI, I was very hesitant because I was not sure that anything I would be getting from Patna. But when I came to ADRI, my whole perception changed. And in these 25 years, I must say, this is the only organization which has grown like anything, and it has blossomed into a very young, energetic, 25 years old organization. Now, to begin with, my presentation would be first on how literacy came into the life of human beings. Now, if you see, human brain is not wired for reading and writing. It is wired only for speaking. And speech evolved some 100,000 years ago. Reading and writing is a recent acquisition, and it is a tool which came in the hands of human beings much later. Now let us see how man progressed. The historical journey right from Africa, which you learned yesterday also, there was no reading and writing. Everything was verbal. And it continued for a pretty long period of time. Empires were built. You know Homer, he was a legendary poet, but illiterate. And so most of the people during Homer, they were all illiterates. But how literacy came and what was the need for literacy? So if you consider that, you start the journey of human life, human civilization. The first stage was the stage, when people were leading a nomadic life, going from one place to other place just for hunting and living. Numbers matter. The groups having large number of persons were high and mighty, while the groups having less number of people were not strong enough. In the second stage, what happened is that because human beings are comparatively less stronger than most of the wild animals, it was necessary for them to domesticate animals, first for the defense and second for commuting from one place to other. So they started domesticating animals, and the group having the most number of domesticated animals were the superior groups. So the second stage was how many numbers of domesticated animals was available. So from the number of human beings, now it transformed into number of domesticated animals which were acquired. In the third transition, what we have seen is this, that from the nomadic existence, people started living in fixed places because it was necessary, because during the long journeys, there was mortality, high rate of mortality among the children. So agriculture started, and when agriculture started, the first thing which was introduced in the mankind was production, consumption, and distribution of food. Now these three things are not there in any of the animals present in the world. There are many animals which are social animals, but there is no animal which is an economic animal. So man essentially is not a social animal, it's basically an economic animal. So what happened is that when this production, consumption, distribution started, the one thing which was required is to keep the records. And for keeping the records, it was necessary to have some symbols. And those symbols, they came into existence. And in Mesopotamia, for the first time, we see some 8,000 years ago, we started putting symbols on the clay vessels, and later on Phoenicians, they gave the idea of the alphabets. So from that started the fourth stage of human civilization, where knowledge became the denominator. Knowledge was essential, and knowledge became the denominator, and knowledge was required for creating wealth, knowledge was required for doing anything which was essential for human existence. So that we are on the fourth stage now. So knowledge is the main denominator. Now if you see the literacy in India, in the ancient period, literacy was quite good. And I quote F.W. Thomas, who wrote in 1891 in his book, British Education in India, I quote, "Education is no exotic in India. There is no country where the love of learning had so early an origin or has exercised so lasting and powerful an influence. From the simple poets of the Vedic age to the Bengali philosophers of the present day, there has been an uninterrupted succession of teachers and scholars." So it was very much there. During the Vedic time, there was some conflict, but then the religions which were created at that time, that the Buddhism and the Jainism, they created their own monasteries and this, that. So that came into that existence. During the Muslim rule, Muslim rulers were quite indifferent to all these education systems. So parallelly, the maktabs and the madrasas and the Indian schooling system continued. The indigenous in the gurukuls continued. Finally, in the British period, there was total collapse of the education system, the Indian education system. And because of the collapse
may I request you to kindly consent on what exactly you are going to do on 10 India's literacy program? Because we have very less time.
Okay.
So
let us.
Yeah. And what are the lessons that one can learn from your understanding? Okay. That is what needs to be conveyed to us.
So I'm going to concentrate now on the literacy initiatives in India. The first cycle was from 1882 to 1942, in which literacy was given through 90 schools, and it was not so successful because at the time of independence, the literacy figure of India was simply 5.93%, the crude literacy rate. The second cycle was started just after the independence, and it was more for the socialization or citizenship training rather than education. In the third cycle, it was from 1967 to 1977, the stress was on functional literacy, farmers education and functional literacy program, functional literacy for adult women. During the fourth cycle, for the first time, there was a pan-India movement, pan-India program for eradication of illiteracy. This was National Adult Education Program, in which 100 million people were thought to be made literate, but only 20% return could be achieved. The next of the fifth cycle started from 1988, from the famous Ernakulam model, and it continued for a pretty long period of time, almost 20 years. It was the first step towards decentralization, towards making district as units for total literacy campaigns, post-literacy campaign, and continuing education program took place in the different districts. For the first time in the history of Indian literacy, almost 12 percentage point growth was recorded during this total literacy campaign, post-literacy campaign, and continuing education programs. The newest variant of this campaign mode is the Sakshar Bharat. And Sakshar Bharat is completely different program from what we have seen in the earlier literacy initiatives in India. During the drafting of this Sakshar Bharat program, the one person who could contribute to the maximum was Dr. Shahbal Gupta. And he, being an economist, used his own perceptions, his own data, the social indicators, which were merged with this. Now, why I say is this. If you see the results which we got, the rise in literacy rate is painfully slow. During the last 110 years, the crude literacy rate has increased by around 59 percentage points, from 5.3% to 64.32%. If you see Russia, in 31 years, it almost eradicated illiteracy just before the beginning of the 20th century. Same with Japan. In 2011 census, the literacy rate of population aged 7 years and above stands at 72.98%, with the males 80.88%, females 64.68%. In 1951, that is the first census after independence.
You have only 1 minute to go.
Okay. So what I would like to emphasize upon is this. What were the reasons for the slow growth? The first, people never showed any interest, both the literate as well as the illiterate. Even if the illiterate attended the program, they left out. Even if the neo-literates continued for some time, they relapsed back into illiteracy. And the data generated by literacy program managers were not analyzed and were treated as false. The data which is now required for making a good and vibrant literacy program should include gender, social groups, rural-urban divide, occupation, economic status, illiterate places, and behavioral aspects. Unfortunately, the only data which has been used till date is the literacy rate of the males and females in the country, or no other aspect has been taken into consideration. Thank you.
Oh, thank you so much. Now, presentation part is over. May I request the discussant to take the word and then make the comments?
Now we are including them, but they are probably lower in their earning overall, but then you included them then, that's why results are going down. So, you know, both ways, it could be like overestimation or underestimation. There are ways to like probably take care of it and we'll have to discuss. Apart from that, only I can just add like 2 points to the data discussion that had happened. And apart from what they said.
I request you to concentrate at least few points which are extraordinarily important in terms of what is called being so controversial or critical or something of that kind. Highlight those things that for the discussion sake it would be very important for us.
Oh, about this?
That's the rest of the other people.
Oh yeah, so, I can just say apart from whatever data issues they raised, only addition I can make. So here are like two graphs from like the best paper on, according to me, in the economics literature on the education. And this comes from Raj Shetty. This is the estimation in the US based on like 2.5 million students and around 18 million tests they did across like 2 decades. And then you can very clearly see, this is basically what is the value of adding a one like, you know, good teacher to the to the classroom. And all across the US they see like having one good teacher can lead to very high outcome of the education or learning outcome. At the same time, it can also lead to very high earning outcomes throughout the life. In the data collecting process, I really hope that sometime we like actually focus on this big picture and we try to collect the data which basically can link student income, right? And then this actually gives you the real picture of like what is the impact of going to, let's say, private school, what is the impact of going to a government school, what is the impact of having one good teacher, what is the impact of having a couple of good teachers, and who are the good teachers, how to identify them, how to intensivize them, and then, you know, how to maybe give them more motivational things to make the outcomes even better. So, I mean, the one thing that can make really like insightful and like really big impact on Indian educational data system or like education policy is basically collecting a data set which can link student, their parental outcome, their background, and the teacher who are they teaching, and their learning outcomes. That would be like awesome, and I really hope, as an like statistician or like economic point of view, we will see some that data point very soon. Thank you.
Oh, thank you so much. Now, Sudhanshu.
Sorry, I speak from here. Thank you, Chairperson, and thank you, Education, that we all are here to discuss about all these things. So I'll start with Professor Sreekanth, and he started with saying that the power of education to induce changes has been well acknowledged in the literature, but at the same time, it is the quality of education which brings these changes. And while saying quality, he mentioned that it is a provisioning process and the outcomes, which is more important while imparting quality education. And at the same time, it is not only the buildings and the employed people termed as the teacher which will bring the changes. So it is the student's learning which is important. And it is interesting to know what is the outcome from the schools. And one way is through the performances in the examination, but if it is conducted fair, then so results are fair. And a key point, statistical analysis that he has used is mean achievement of students. One important thing is that when we analyze data, and the mean that he has analyzed remains just mean if variance is not known to us. So mean is a mean without revealing its variance behind variance from where from sample from where mean is calculated. And the reason for it is that in a particular state or a region or a group that you have analyzed, variations will be different. There might be outliers in a group which will be give you a mean, it will not relate the picture. Educational equity will be achieved, he has said that, with all the efforts, whatever you have mentioned that are highlighted, and in the coming years, I hope that we will achieve that. However, we should, and we are concerned about the efficiency of the educational institutions in achieving the desired outcome. And it has been a general practice to rank outcomes based on the general OECSC and ST, whatever information. Whenever we get information on social statistics, we do that without worrying within group heterogeneity that is possible, which will affect. So we should worry at the same time. I mean, enough is when we discussed about these groups, but within group variations, you should incorporate when you present information on that. And I agree with the conclusion that the family support surrounding surrounding environments, employment status, and all these things play a key role in the school achievements. Coming to the next presentation by Pradeep, we have been discussing the need for evidence-based decision-making, and this is why we all do research, that we should gather evidence before making any conclusion with regards to any policy. And yes, there are many sources of educational statistics, and there will be many sources because One way to get statistics is a universal statistical system that we can have. But the way socio-economic issues are analyzed, we take up a question and then we start looking for the data. And in the process, we will have many sources of the data. So it is up to the researchers how they are going to utilize that information. And it should not worry us if definitions are varying from one source of the data to the different source. So data, but at the end we need to analyze it. So for a particular purpose, people collect that and hence meanings with different. So there's a long list of desirable statistics that we should have. At the same time, it is the question or the issue. We all agree with that, which is important. And it is important to effectively utilize data that we have.
You don't have to read all that. I mean, it's just
get the reading. I mean, if you read it, you will not find all these things. So it is different thing. Coming to the Reddy's point that, okay, there are gaps in the database, and he has he has presented what all database is available for analysis. So there is a gap, and we hope that these gaps will be filled. So and at the end, I thank Jammu also to present something which is different from what we heard from three other presenters. So it was interesting to hear you. Thank you very much.
Good. Thank you so much. Now this session is open for discussion. Yeah, but to remind again, cryptic to the point, not away from the text on which the presentation is being made. Thank you so much. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Okay. Now this is, yeah, after that. Yes.
My name is Govind Bharatwaj. I work in the CHM of India, and I've been assisting the ADRI since the inception. I have got one question each to the first three speakers. First to Professor Sreekanth. Now, we have spoken about the service. The service bring out the fact that somehow the SCs were doing better, some of the SCs were doing better, some of the OBCs were doing better. And, you know, we have also made an observation that economic background was more important, according to the survey, than social background in determining the outcome of the educational policies. So, is it time to stop looking at the problem from the prism of castes, to move away from the caste analysis and to look at it from the point of view of empowerment, opportunity, or the lack of this? My second question is to Professor Reddy. You have mentioned about service exemption and other initiatives in the government. Now, these government initiatives, you know, focus mainly on the coverage rather than quality. In fact, in terms of coverage and enrollment, you know, Indian experience has been very good. While coverage has taken a quantum jump, quality has taken nosedive. It has nosedived. Second, you mentioned about the RT. Now, the RT Act is again, you know, in the focus for the Subramanian Committee report, especially its recommendation about the non-detention of children till class 8. Now, when we grew up as kids, you know, it was very normal to have children studying in class 1 to be retained. That at least ensured that, you know, when you don't have the students studying in class 8 who cannot read the textbooks of class 4 or class 5. Okay. So, is it time to look at it again, and, you know, when they start attention from class 1?
Absolutely.
Onwards.
Okay.
And the third question is to Professor Choudhury. You have
make it short, please.
Only one sentence.
Yeah.
You have mentioned about some hidden agenda based on the negotiation policy. I would like to be enlightened about the hidden agenda.
Thank you. Oh, thank you. Now, perhaps later on after, yeah, collecting all the things. Okay, fine. Yes.
I'm Sanjay Kumar, associated with the Digital Society, Delhi. One question and one suggestion. Professor Sreekanth, first I congratulate for your very reflective and insightful presentation. My question is, what is the policy implication? What is the policy implication of the recommendation on the basis of your key finding in order to linkage it between quote unquote home and school? Your key findings clearly show the learning achievement of the children get affected directly the home background of the socioeconomic context of the parents. And that I have a humble suggestion to Dr. Choudhury, please take a very positive note. I would like to bring attention. You have touched many things and many issues, but unfortunately, I'm very sorry to share this comment. I have not built up your central question with reference to the central argument. So I just suggest humbly to kindly to narrow down the focus of your paper if you present a future on this theme. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you so much. Anybody else? Yeah. Yes. And after that, you. Yes.
Hello, I am Dilip from Population Research Center, Patna. Some three questions with different participants we had. This thing, the first participant, I have questioned whether this is the survey research or what, and of which year. We have taken out this one, some rigid burden like that, for the dropouts. Is that linked up with the private school? What is the situation in the private school? What is the facility of this one, safe drinking water, sanitation, the implication of that one, of the SC, ST and OBC and others, these things. And those one participant, Dr. P.K. Choudhury, that you have taken this one for teaching in the planning process, this one. Where is the research part? Whether government is taking it or not? In the university, this is the research. They are only for the promotion sake or what? Or some other research agency will do the research. Research is where? Where is the research? We have to be very much clear of that one. And the fourth participant, Professor Jamwar Sahab, whether you can please, this is a link up of this one. You have a long back of this historical, this one, literacy and other things. Can you, focus on this one, demographic transition with this one, link up of this literacy rate? Absolutely. So it will give some better results or outcomes.
Thank you so much. Very interesting. Yeah. You want this? You want this?
Yes.
Can I get a mic?
I have a short question for Mr. Reddy. My name is Arvind Varma. I'm from Indiana University, Bloomington. The way that you were describing the school statistics reminds me so closely about the crime statistics about which I'll be talking in the afternoon. So I just wanted to say that we're having the same problem with the police statistics as you seem to be having with the school statistics. But you mentioned that from 1990 onwards, there have been some new ways of developing new kinds of statistics. I'm sorry you went too fast, I couldn't catch up, and the chair was rightly very strict about it. But I caught one point, which you said that some of the data collection was initiated because for some specific purposes. Could you just talk a little bit about it?
Thank you. Thank you.
Discussion method, workshop method, so many methods, because traditional teaching method is a very traditional method, lecture method. So I think that educational system, it depends upon four components. First is teacher, student, parents, and administration. So how to quality education without any changing of teaching method, because lecture method is a traditional method. So many methods, debate method, seminar method, discussion method, workshop, because so I think that Bihar, specifically in Bihar, so many problems because research methodology, paper in higher education is essential. But yahan se problem ye hai ki bachche samajhte nahi hai. और उनको रिसर्च चूंकि ये आदरी ये रिसर्च पर ज़्यादा फोकस देते हैं तो बच्चे रिसर्च मेथोलॉजी में यहाँ का कट एंड पेस्ट चल रहा है. सॉरी सर, अगर कोई जनरल ये काम करते होंगे तो उनके प्रति मेरा समर्पित भाव है. तो वो सिर्फ यही समझते हैं कि हमको किसी तरह से कट पेस्ट से आ जाना चाहिए. तो मैं समझती हूँ सर कि क्लासरूम टीचिंग में अगर इसको बदलाव लाया जाए, वर्कशॉप के जरिए सिलेबस जो हमारा रहता है उसी को अगर हम सेमिनार के रूप में, जो हमारा मेन यूनिट है उसको अगर हम थीम माने और उसके अंदर जो भी रहा उसको सब थीम के द्वारा सेमिनार पर, तो एक एक्साइटिंग क्लासेस हो जाता है वर्कशॉप पर. मतलब मैंने इसका एप्लीकेशन भी किया. क्या आप इसको समझते हैं या नहीं, इसको हमें बताएं.
ओके ओके ओके, दैट थैंक यू सो मच. यस,
I'm Jyotsna from CBPS Bangalore. This is to Dr. Reddy. As a user of DICE data, it's a very useful data despite all limitations, and the fact that one can easily access it is also great. But one thing that we have found, especially in the last 3-4 years, we use raw DICE data quite a bit, that the 5% check I know is there, but I think it has its own issues. And the data cleaning process seems to be weak, because when you go to raw data, the inconsistencies are very high. So I feel that a lot can be done actually by just consistency checks, robustness checks, and by cleaning the data, the processing of the data, if that is strengthened, that would make it much more useful. That is one. Second is that over the years, why has all, I mean, UGC or NUPA not developed a system for higher education data? That's something like I have been wanting to know. Because that's completely, especially because last 2 decades have seen private universities and institutions coming in, and we have no knowledge base on that. So that is a serious gap.
Okay, thank you much. I don't think there is any. Only one question, not more than one. Okay, two, or two, oh, fine. Okay.
Hello. Very briefly, this question is to Professor Sreekanth. From your presentation, it's evident that SC, ST lag behind the others in general. But also from the other sources, we know that religious minority, especially the Muslims, lag behind in the educational attainment, especially in the West Bengal, Bihar, etc. So don't you think that if they club in the general category or maybe in the OBC category, that's height, then it reveals the educational attainment. Thank you.
Yes, absolutely. And I think no other questions there. So I must thank all of you to participate in this discussion. As I could see that this the type of issues being raised are really so rich and so much it has potential for having discussion for more than few hours or so, if really one wants to discuss with them. But then we've not had time to do. What I'm suggesting is that to the speakers, that not that we have to respond to all queries or questions. Whatever you feel very important and very critical, you might like to address them, and then we'll stop at that. We cannot continue for long. Yeah.
Thank you very much for the very useful comments, observations, and queries. With regard to the data, we have information completely on various aspects, including variance and all that. So I've presented only means in terms of significance of difference, whether across these groups, whether there is any significance of difference. And it shows that, yes, these groups have a significant mean achievement difference. That's one thing. Second thing is that it has huge implications for home background, and it continues to be. So in fact, the purpose of schooling has to do away with all these, the implications of home background and all. They have to be reduced, they have to be sidelined if the schooling happens properly, but that is not happening. Still, the home variables do matter. And when it comes to our surveys, we have not included private schools. It's only government and government-aided schools. And these surveys are conducted between 2001 to 15, that is last year, and across different cycles. So cycles means 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. We have conducted under different cycles. Yes, the quality of education is very important, and it cannot be determined by large-scale achievement surveys, though in our testing, we administer quality tools which significantly provide an understanding of how students are performing, and that's how you have got this mean achievement variations and all that. Yes, I do understand that at micro level, there could be so many variations which can impact the performance of the students, but we have not taken all those things into consideration. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Anybody else? Yeah.
Last observation on my situation from just now. Yeah, we do have some mechanisms to clean the data, but as I said in the beginning, that the data, the system of DICE is inextricably linked or embedded in SSA and RMSA, and they have their own ways of working. Say, for example, every year they have to undergo the process of PAB to get the money, and by PAB the data has to be ready. So sometimes the quality is traded off to the timeliness of the data. That's how somewhere I think the cleaning was not taken as seriously as it ought to have taken, therefore some things are there. But we are making our own efforts, but this is a trade-off. I think I have totally misunderstood my timing, sir. I thought that I'm just giving evaluation of changing status, but I did not come to the persistent problems, or that these are the persistent, some of the persistent problems that I. And the second thing is that Vikas has mentioned that there has to be an architecture of data collection system to understand the education system is student, teacher, and socioeconomic status and outcomes. This is the kind of architecture one need to understand to examine the problems in education or efficiency in education system. Yes, I think more or less we are moving in that direction towards the end of my slide that is there. Government of India is toying with the idea of collecting student-wise information linked with Aadhaar, linked with what we call all students, all grades, every year tested. It's not a no more a sample based. This kind of architecture is likely to develop how far we go, how far we are successful. But at the same time, this also raises issues of what you call low stake versus high stake testing. And when you test all students, every grade, every year, then the distinction between low stakes and high stakes testing collapses, to my mind. I think I have not got all the points. Yeah, on higher education, yes. Minister of HRD, Department of EMS has started, but later on, because of certain other reasons, MHRD has taken over. MHRD has indeed started something called All India Higher Education Survey in 2010-11 or 11-12. But the coverage is quite limited at this moment of time, but they are also producing the data like DICE, and they are also willing to share promises, share the primary unit level data with the researchers, but it is located in MHRD statistics division. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Anything else?
Yeah. I forgot about you, but I think there is one question. I'm G1 basically. as you are right to mention, I think yesterday he was also mentioning that when he was speaking about crime statistics as a question, he said that police statistics are disbelieved, but the next door health center statistics and education statistics are believed. I think I was at that point of time, like, even health education statistics are also disbelieved. These days, of course, the variation is coming down, but even education statistics are also a bit disbelieved. For many reasons, the moment you link data, but how can it be other way around, I do not know. The moment you link data with certain provisions, say for example, how many teachers will be there in school, how many blackboards or how many chalk pieces will be sent to the school based on enrollment, then there is every incentive to inflate or deflate enrollments. And that's what exactly happening in the education sector also. If I deflate, say for example, I'm a school of 58 children, but if I inflate into 61, I get 3 teachers. Because as per RTE, up to 60, I can have only 2 teachers. The moment I cross 61,
it's not another
61, then I can have 3 teachers. Therefore, every incentive is there to deflate by margins. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much.
Yeah, I can understand.
Thanks for the comments. It will really help me to improve my paper. One issue came up like research in universities. I highlighted something. Like, there are many issues in this, including the API issue in higher education, and also the balance between teaching and research. Like in state universities, more emphasis is given on teaching, but that is not being counted in API. That also now we are talking about. The new API also comes, they are also, we are emphasizing on research. The teaching research issue is still a persisting problem, particularly in state universities, that I want to highlight. I don't have other things.
Okay, thank you. Next, yeah.
There was a suggestion for link up of literacy rates, right from 1982 to the present day. I must tell you, sir, that research in the field of adult literacy is very, very sparse. You won't find much reference anywhere, especially in Indian conditions. Even the books on adult literacy is not available. Whenever you have to formulate something for adult literacy, you do not have any background material. So the first thing is that it has to come to the center of the, or it has to be mainstream in the education policies. But it is an essential endowment, it should be there, so that efforts can be taken for improving the research in this field and linking up this research with all other activities of human rights. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I think it's over. I think only thing that a few lines, only one or two lines that I'd like to, as a chairperson of this seminar, of this session, only thing that all through I've been thinking, I was thinking that we have crossed 60s, we have spent only 69, almost 70 years of the independence, still we are really struggling to capture the reality through our database. And education is something which is a natural right for every human individual, every human being, in any nation on the planet. Something like water, health and education, this is something which is natural. Everybody has the equal right to have, to gain access to this. It's a natural right, uncontested, is a natural right. And it's the state we have created to provide them. Who created the state? We created the state. Our forefathers, to see that these are the natural rights being given to these people. And when I was hearing, and I was thinking that, well, this is something great, is the first reflections on the data set that you have been using. I also did not so many studies, few studies on education, and I used extensively secondary data. And then, of course, like me, there are some of the best brains in education in India, they also did. And I found that then, in many cases, the kind of conclusion that you have been able to draw from those studies, I think the fresh reflections required. It means that tomorrow we are going to have education policy, new education policy. Again, we need to depend on the secondary data, the data that is collected by different institutions. Now, I do not know how valid they could be. The struggle is going on. Let the struggle going on. And finally, I think we will be able to see some end of the dark tunnel. The question is that removal of illiteracy. Question is that removal of educational background is a country like India. How far, when, and when we will be able to do. Perhaps the critical reflections of the process which ADRI has initiated, something of this kind, has tremendous, is commendable value, has tremendous value and commendable job that they are doing. I appreciate them, appreciate my here, those who have been sitting in the panel. Thank you very much for all of you having raised very pertinent issue. I thank the organization. Thank you so much for having invited me to be here. Thank you.
Okay, we have lunch now. And unfortunately, we have to cut short on the lunch, but I think it was worth it. Thank you all for your participation. And we will really strictly start at 2:50, 2:15, okay? Yeah.